Good afternoon. Today is Monday, the 18th of March, 2024, just after 1 o'clock. Welcome to UK Column News. I'm your host, Brian Gerrish, and I'm delighted to have with me today Alex Thomson, talking from the Netherlands, and we've also got Mark Anderson speaking from the United States. Well, we're going to get straight on with the election of Putin. Of course, this has caused huge angst in the Western governments, and we've only got to have a look at some of the headlines to see the vitriol that's come across as a result of an 88% of the vote for Putin. So we've got snarling Vladimir Putin's chilling switch to anger and defiance in election victory. Putin says Russian election indicates trust and hope in him. Putin may be the biggest dupe of his fake election landslide. And the critical one we'll bring in here, Putin warns of World War III if Western troops enter Ukraine as he wins another election. So, Alex, I'll welcome you into today's news and just ask you what you think. I had to smile because, of course, I've seen over many, many elections in UK and the West what is essentially the controlling of the vote by massive amounts of money to influence which way the public are going to vote. And of course, we've seen the shambles in the United States over recent years. It seems a bit rich for the finger to be pointed at Putin, but perhaps I'm being cynical again.
Well, Putin did himself lay his finger on this issue you just raised of US vote fraud in acceptance speeches. He has, as has been accurately subtitled by outlets available in the West, he did say that the USA is now a joke electorally. He knows very well what the game is. I mean, he, being a man who believes in strong central rule, although Russia is also a federal state, has often said, we Russians have a very different system from the US. We don't quite understand. A lot of Europeans say the same thing. We don't understand how the US states and counties have so much sovereignty. But nevertheless, he has come out and done what he never did before. I'm not cheerleading for him. I'm just observing. Whereas until a few months ago, he would have said the internal political affairs of the United States are not for me as president of the Russian Federation to speak about. He is now saying you don't have a leg to stand on. Cynics would, of course, say that that's him deflecting. But I think the point is solidly made. Now, the wider question, of course, is whether Putin really has full and total control of domestic and warfare policy in Russia. Perhaps we'll put on in the show notes for a contrarian and well-informed view, a recent interview by Yuria Voroshka of Moldova, pleading that that isn't the case. But be that as it may, Putin's electoral victory is, shall we say, perhaps only slightly massaged by Western standards. I think the overwhelming majority of the population, the large majority anyway, and certainly outside the three main cities, did vote for him.
Okay, Alex, thank you for that. Well, let's just look at a tiny bit of this video clip. We'll just play it on screen and talk through. But what happens here is that Putin gets asked a question by this journalist, and he's really saying, well, what is the West going to do? What do they think now you've been re-elected? And in Putin's response, he says, well, they're going to become ever more cunning. So I don't think there's any doubt that Putin doesn't know what's coming. The West doesn't like him being re-elected, and we're seeing all the dirty tricks in the background. And of course, if we go on to this earlier clip from 2014, this is another big thorn in the paw of the West, that Putin, of course, has been popular and in power for so long. And this really gives him a very strong base. And was regime change the objective with the all of the machinations in Ukraine? Well, absolutely it was. But he's still there. Now, let's have a look at a man who's very wobbly at the moment, and that's Defence Secretary Grant Shapps. The papers are covering this story that he was forced to abandon a Odessa trip due to what they labelled as security concerns. I chose the report from forces.net here, but this was over the UK media. And let's have a look at a little bit of the detail of that. So Grant Shapps was busy sounding off. He said that Putin had shown himself to be reckless, ruthless, and careless. The fact he came perilously close to essentially assassinating two Western leaders. It doesn't matter whether that is deliberate or accidental. Now, he's referring to an earlier Russian missile strike. He went on to say in this article, what the hell is he, Putin, doing? And why the heck would the West allow him to do that kind of thing? Well, what is Putin doing? He's doing what he's always done, which is accurate missile strikes on military targets in Ukraine. And the strike that had taken place earlier is the key one. So let's have a look at some of the other headlines before we put in the reality. But here we are. Shapps cancelled his Odessa trip over fears of assassination because Moscow had suddenly become aware of his position, allegedly. Grant Shapps forced to cancel Ukraine port trip due to threat of Russian missile strike. And experts warn RAF critical aircraft are effectively defensive after electronic warfare attacks by the Russians. So let's put the headline in over the top. Well, what had really happened is that the previous Russian missile strike in the Odessa area had wiped out a significant number of Western military advisors, including French specialists responsible, apologies for the typo there, for operating and targeting weapon systems in Ukraine. So this is what made Shapps get very nervous and call off the trip, was that another batch of Western advisors have been killed by the Russians, as they said they would do if these people got involved in Ukraine itself. And if we pop this up on screen, obviously from social media, but it makes a key point that it is the help of the NATO nations, Europe, UK, the US. And if we just bring in the arrow, we can see at top right of the map, we've got Odessa showing its key position. And if we move the pointer down, we'll see that this is one of the US battlefield surveillance aircraft that are providing such vital battlefield targeting for the Ukrainians. So it's no wonder that the Russians are so keen to deal with the Odessa problem. And this is the reason why we've heard Macron and other Western leaders talking about the importance of stopping the Russians moving into Odessa and that local region. So here's Mr. Grant Shapps. This is the man who ran away from Odessa. But of course, if we have a look at his tweets, what do we discover? Well, this is the man who wants every other nation to fight his proxy war. He's keen for the British troops to be involved. And that'll be very interesting to see how they fare up against the Russian forces. But here he is saying that, those Polish people have kept us safe before, and presumably they can keep us safe in the future. So he runs away from danger, but he wants other nations and British forces to keep him safe. It's pretty sickening stuff. And if people are still not sure how the war in Ukraine is going, I'll just put up one image from Weeb Union. And if we can just bring that one on screen. What we see here is all these little yellow marks are defensive positions. The reddish color to the right of the screen, Russian territory, to the left of the screen, Ukrainian. And basically, the Ukrainians are now moving back from the long prepared defensive into much weaker spread defences. Many of these trenches are not proper trenches, and the Ukrainians suffering huge losses. I'll just show you this clip of a Russian strike on a Ukrainian drone position. This is where the Russians are now causing more and more casualties in the Ukrainian sector. So if we just activate that little video clip, we'll see another strike, and that will be more dead Ukrainians in an instant. But of course, it's not only male soldiers that are dying on the Ukrainian battlefield, because as we'll see from the next picture, we've now got horrific wounds to women who are fighting. And I don't know whether the lady in the picture has lost both her arms and part of a leg. Possibly she's got one arm behind her, but certainly she has lost one arm at the shoulder. So this is what Grant Shapps and his team are encouraging, more people to die. Social media taking the mickey out of Macron, as we can see in this particular image. What does the picture show? Well, it's Macron looking at a bust of Napoleon. And Macron's asking, what do you mean God is with Russia? And the secondary label by Napoleon is, well, go find out. And the reality in France has been over recent days that there have been protests, which we can just bring up on screen. And people do not want those French troops to be going to Ukraine, but not reported in West. So those are the bad people, because they're protesting essentially for peace and against the war. But if we can just bring Grant Shapps back on screen in his own little video clip, what have we got? Well, have a look and judge the man for what he is.
Okay, rolling. I want to tell you about a great offer coming to you. It's the Great British Rail Sale, offering over 1 million advance tickets to passengers with up to a massive 50% off. Why not take a trip to Edinburgh to take in the sweeping views from Arthur's Seat? Or if it's sea and sand that you want, well, head to Cornwall with its stretches of beautiful sand and crashing waves. Or visit the Lake District, the land of dancing daffodils and full of love from Wordsworth's paradise. Or come down to London for a bit of retail therapy. You know, we've had 2 years of living life virtually. It's time to get real and visit our beautiful country.
And cut.
So maybe it would be slightly amusing if he wasn't the man who's running a proxy war where 400,000 dead, possibly more at the moment, but he wants more troops in on the ground, more nations involved in that proxy war. I'll leave our audience to judge Grant Shapps for themselves. Now let's move on to Mark Anderson, and welcome to today's news, Mark. You've been having a look at the Council for Foreign Relations, which of course is often at the back of a lot of the globalist plans.
Good morning, Brian and everyone, and happy St. Pat's Day, one day removed, to the viewers and the staff at UK Column. Yeah, this is sort of the Rosetta Stone of what's going on. And I'll mention, don't forget last week's report where I talked about the Chicago version of the Council on Foreign Relations, the Chicago Council on Global Affairs, and they did that survey. And many people in America don't want any more involvement in Ukraine, but they want Ukraine to join NATO. And if that happens, that would oblige America and other countries, signatories to NATO, to come to Ukraine's defense in the war. So this is a major thing to keep an eye on. Is that the idea all along, the main fundamental idea, to get Ukraine into NATO, and then everything becomes a fait accompli? But anyway, this slide that we're looking at here, this next one, is this seminal article by the now late Richard Gardner, a longtime Columbia University professor. He was in the State Department, Trilateral Commission, CFR, of course. In this article, this is the 50-year anniversary of this all-important article, The Hard Road to World Order by Richard Gardner. And we'll quote it a little bit. It's kind of self-explanatory. Now, here's a slide as a preliminary item. This is a quote from the current edition of Foreign Affairs. Foreign Affairs is the ongoing CFR journal where the Hard Road to World Order appeared. Of course, that journal's been in existence a long time. This is a little something out of the current edition, March, April, 2024. It's become trite to say that liberalism is in crisis. This is written by Helena Rosen, Rosenblatt, I think it is. She talks about illiberal democracy being the system that we must support around the world, and fundamentalism, authoritarianism, populism, and all of these things are not alternative worldviews. They're not other ways of thinking. They're described as threats, literal threats. And so basically, in this current article, she's saying that anything other than neoliberalism is illiberal, and not only illiberal, but not only illogical, but a outright threat. So in other words, neoliberalism is the only way to go. So it's a very monopolistic way of thinking. Populism is out, any kind of authoritarianism is out, et cetera, et cetera. Keeping that in mind, now we're going back to this article that came out 50 years ago, actually 50 years ago next month. And here's what Richard Gardner had to say. We are witnessing an outbreak of short-sighted nationalism. Think about that. They still say the same thing today. We're witnessing an outbreak of short-sighted nationalism that seems oblivious to the economic, political, and moral implications of interdependence. We'll keep going from there. And yet never has there been such widespread recognition by the world's intellectual leadership of the necessity for cooperation and planning on a truly global basis beyond country. But the real clincher is the next statements after that in this 20-page article. In short, a house of world order will have to be built from the bottom up rather than the top down. It will look like a great booming, buzzing confusion, to use William James' famous description of reality. But an end run around national sovereignty, eroding it piece by piece, will accomplish much more than the old-fashioned frontal assault. And that comment there, the last couple slides, many analysts have cited as a instance where the CFR has taken the gloves off and revealed its real true essence, that it's all about eroding national sovereignty piece by piece to form a world government, and that it would provide the studies and the intellectual input and the personnel in government to make that happen over the decades since the CFR was founded in 1921. So this is an important cornerstone to cite, Brian, in terms of understanding world affairs today.
Mark, thank you very much for that. And we'll be able to link into some of those concepts when we start talking about local authorities in the second half of the news. So really good segue. Alex, let's bring you back in. Well, what about Switzerland, a bastion of democracy, or is it?
At least one canton isn't, Brian. Just before I get stuck into that, I think what Mark has just set out explains eloquently to us from a 50-year perspective why it is not just that, as you say, we have local councils obeying supranational or NGO orders, which have come from the likes of the CFR, but equally explain why this bottom-up push is coming through the culture. It hasn't come by accident, this push for radical change. Right, Martin Sellner, for those who do not know, is an identitarian activist, and the originally French term identitaire means somebody who believes that the indigenous or autochthonous peoples of the Western European or Western countries have a right to advocate for their continued existence as a majority in their own homelands, despite demographic change through mass immigration. The identitarian movement is largely well-educated and youthful, and is known for its brave but lawful actions. Unfurling banners, for example, has got itself in a lot of hot water in a lot of countries, including France. Sellner is from Vienna, Austria. His wife, Brittany, is from Oregon and lives with him now in Vienna. We recently reported in late January, the link will be in the show notes, the 29th of January episode, that Sellner had got himself an extremely rare breach of the Schengen Agreement, which is that participating member states can allow their citizens to travel freely. He was declared persona non grata within that and booted out of Germany by the unlovable German Interior Minister, Nancy Faeser. After that, he went to the Swiss canton of Aargau. The canton is significant. I'll be explaining in a moment why. To give a book launch, a book presentation, as they would call it on the continent, for his book Remigration, which people are translating remigration, but a more accurate term, given it's the use of the idea in history, in English history, would be voluntary repatriation. That's what remigration is. This is the plan that was discussed innocuously enough, it seems, by him in Potsdam near Berlin recently, when the German feds decided to tip off an equivalent of Hope Not Hate called Correctiv to bug a clock on the wall of the hotel suite so that the scandal could break and that the German Verfassungsschutz, the equivalent of FBI or MI5, could wash their hands of it and say it wasn't us, mate. Well, Sellner was giving his presentation or book launch in Aargau, and with apologies that the first few seconds are muffled recording, don't turn your volume up or you'll be deafened afterwards. But if you listen to it carefully, you'll hear what's being said if you speak German. This is what happened at the book launch.
In der dritten Salon, das Menschen macht es, steckt auch ein großer Leistung. Egal. Haben wir zuerst den Strom abgedreht? Zeit verlangt von uns, dass wir die Veranstaltung auflösen. Sie werden auch jetzt den Raum betreten. Wir haben uns nicht zu Schulden lassen, kommt ihr zumindest nicht. Wir werden die Veranstaltung auflösen. Jeder wird.
Ich hoffe, dass wieder Meinungsfreiheit und Vernunft in die Schweiz einkehrt. Bevölkerungsaustausch findet statt und Remigration ist die Lösung.
Now, despite the writing in English on the side of that blue police van that said border guards, these are in fact, or the leadership of that operation on Saturday, the 16th of March, was the cantonal police of Aargau, one of these 26 cantons in Switzerland. Here is Martin Sellner's description in his statement on Telegram, and I think other platforms as well, of what happened. He says, today the police in the canton of Aargau, Switzerland, stormed the speech, turned off the electricity, handcuffed me. Well, you saw that the first thing they did was say everybody out, and performed a pushback. Now, this isn't Sellner's English leaving anything to be desired. His English is brilliant. Because he's well-versed now in immigration law, which is a very specific and complex area of international and domestic law, he's using the term correctly. A pushback is prima facie an unlawful act by a state when it sees somebody and says, before interviewing him, I don't like the look of you, you're going back over my border. This being Switzerland, which is as decentralized as the USA, it's only the canton of Aargau that banned him. The Swiss feds were not involved. He says, I'm not allowed to enter the canton for 2 months. The reason I presented my book, and the police said, this is the first time we've removed somebody from our canton for 10 years, while 50,000 illegals entered Switzerland as a whole, the 26 cantons, in 2023. But he says that his ideas will inevitably spread. Here he is on X, formerly Twitter, saying that he will challenge the decision. And it's interesting to see what he has given by way of documentation here. First of all, the reason that he was given for being booted out of the canton was he was threatening public order and security by saying it is possible to induce people to remigrate voluntarily. Elon Musk replied, is this legal? Well, Mr. Musk, if you're sincerely asking, I don't know. The question these days is all down to which judge you have and which jurisdiction you're in, because there's such a mishmash of cantonal, Swiss, and to some extent ECHR jurisprudence on this that would all cross cut against each other. Look at the documents he was given. First, equivalent to getting a naughty boy banning order by from the high street by the British police, is a red delineated map of the canton saying, you not come here for 2 months, naughty boy. And here is the front page of his banning order signed by the cantonal police. If we zoom in there, we see that the one-line summary by the Aargau cantonal police of the case was removed speaker at an event which, in this wonderful officious German, is described as, which could be described as belonging to the right-wing scene. And then the reason for removal, it is for the preservation of public order and security. Sicherheit covers a multitude of sins in German-speaking countries. And here's the really scandalous thing. It is assumed, that is by the police, that if he stays on the territory of the canton, further rallies might happen. Oh dear, we can't have that. Now, why did I say Aargau is significant? Well, because Dr. Thomas Binder has his cardiology practice in that very canton. And Sellner got off lightly, you could say, because when Thomas Binder describes on social media, he wasn't quite in agreement with the official COVID narrative in the early days of lockdown, the Aargau cantonal police, it's only a titchy canton too, they sent 60 armed police to get him out. So he's perhaps got off lightly, has Sellner, and that's a Binder interview will be in the show notes. He may even be watching it. He's a regular viewer now, is Dr. Binder. Similar things happening in Britain, of course, and here is a comparison with the, you could call it the Streisand effect, happening with Patriotic Alternative last week being declared extremists without being proscribed by the Home Office, a bit like that CFR saying liberal democracy, and now last week we see that we are defending, the state is defending liberal parliamentary democracy. It gets ever more specific, but we see the roots of it go back to Rockefeller thinking. Well, Patriotic Alternative, the subject of this, we say non-legal naughty boy order last week. They've had a complete spike in their Google searches last week. This was shared by Laura Towler, who, as we reported recently, has recently had to see her husband, Sam Melia, imprisoned for his stickers.
Okay, well, yes, it's coming here. Well, it's not going to be long before it's here. And if it was British police making that arrest, it would have been at least eight of them, in my opinion, and not the two that we saw in the Swiss canton. Mark, let's bring you back, because America, of course, huge problems on its southern border. And again, dare people speak out?
Lots of things are happening today. This day is very pivotal, not just this issue. I'll mention briefly that on March 4, there was a stay issued on SB 4, Senate Bill 4 in Texas, that would allow Texas to act like a nation state and detain and deport those that illegally enter the Lone Star State. Well, that law had a stay issued against it March 4, and on March 12, Samuel Alito, Associate Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States, extended the stay until today, March 18, 4 p.m. U.S. Central Time in Texas. So as of today, get this afternoon at 4 o'clock local time, we'll find out if Texas, number one, has the courage to enforce SB 4 and to see if anyone else at the federal government level, let's say Biden somehow with an executive order, whatever it might be, to see if anyone else interferes. So it's a real testing ground to see if Abbott's got the political will to actually enforce that law. But in the meantime, we have a slide here that shows a very ironic and puzzling situation. I'll describe it. Governor Abbott sends 105,000 migrants to sanctuary cities. Now, many conservatives are cheering this. You go, Governor Abbott, you're going to show those liberals in those blue cities. You're going to show them what for. You're going to show them how hard it is to handle all these illegals. And here's some specifics in the next slide. Texas has transported over 105,000 migrants to these sanctuary cities, over 12,500 to Washington, D.C., almost 40,000 to New York City, a little over 32,000 to Chicago, 3,400 to Philadelphia, 16,700 to Denver, and about 1,500 to L.A. Until Biden does his job, this is Greg Abbott's own ex post, until Biden does his job to secure the border, Texas will continue to hold the line. But here is the problem. 105,000 migrants going into the internal United States is actually the trafficking or the importing of the people that have illegally crossed the border. So Abbott, according to many critics I've talked about, may be putting on a good show, but he's still sending over 100,000 of those who ought to have been detained, possibly deported, and sending them into the internal United States, into the very sanctuary cities where the migrants want to go. So many, many border watchers, people that are right in the Rio Grande River's water that I know of, that have really been up close and personal on this issue, they're very upset about this. They think it's a lot of play acting and double dealing by Governor Abbott. But get this next slide. The Biden administration sets a target to deport 125,000 migrants in 2025, only half the number that were deported in 2019 when Mr. Trump was in there. But get that, Biden wants to deport 125,000, yet Abbott is sending over 100,000 into the interior and acting like it's a good thing. So a lot of people are crying foul on this, guys. They believe that Abbott is being duplicitous. They don't trust him. And you have that Senate Bill 4 decision today. That stay is dropping, and we'll see. So today is the bellwether day on whether Texas is really going to enforce its border and mean what it says and says what it mean. And just to wind up here, this is from the American Civil Liberties Union of Texas, a very, very left-wing outfit. And they're reminding us SB 4 is currently scheduled to take effect no earlier than today, March 18th at 4 p.m. Central Time. And they're saying the U.S. District Court for the Western District of Texas initially blocked this unconstitutional law from going into effect. However, the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals reversed that decision. The ACLU wants the Supreme Court to uphold any measure that would prevent SB 4 from coming into effect. And basically, readers and viewers can get more details from the show notes. The ACLU is explaining a little bit more about this. They're saying the new law authorizes untrained police officers to engage in immigration enforcement. That's a bit out of focus. They're very well trained. They're saying it creates a new unconstitutional process in which the Texas police are permitted to detain people suspected of being non-U.S. citizens. And actually, the Texas Constitution provides the groundwork for this. And when the federal government fails, kind of like the doctrine of the lesser magistrates, Texas, it's their prerogative to step in and fill the void. So that's what's going on, a very pivotal time for immigration. And we'll see if Texas is up to the challenge.
Mark, thank you very much for that. As you took us through that report, your earlier segment on the Council for Foreign Relations came in my head, and the expression was buzzing confusion. And this is one of the things we see worldwide, chaos in immigration. Borders are open, people are coming in, some of them are considered dangerous, and then we're going through the rigmarole of trying to get people out of the country where they haven't been checked when they come in. This is happening in America. It's happening in the UK. And there's an undertone of this globalist policy. We'll get more onto that in a minute. But let's just say, if you like what the UK column does, then please do join us, become members. It's a relatively small number of people who subscribe and donate to UK column, take out a paid membership. They are the ones that keep us going. We would like many more people to do the same to enable us to expand. Now, you can help us by buying something from the UK column shop, and I'll add to what's on screen, which of course is the t-shirts, that we also have had great interest in the stickers that we've now got, but in fact we're sold out, so we're waiting for an order to come in on that. But you can also share our material. It is put out there to be shared, but please do acknowledge us when you do that. Now, information or new articles up on the UK column website. We've got Seeing the Wood from the Trees, Farming and Habitat in Wales with Gareth Wynne-Jones. So that's a very interesting discussion there. I'd also like to say that we're getting great interest in the Green King discussion, which Debbie Evans and myself have been having. So if you haven't yet seen part one and two of the Green King, I encourage you to do it, because it's asking a lot of questions. And I'll just say that we understand that will be some announcement apparently on Wednesday from the royal family, but we don't know the subject or the topic, but a lot of people seem to be talking about this. Now, this lady I did an interview with recently. That interview will go out Tuesday at 1 o'clock. Madeleine Hunt, the General Secretary from the Heritage Party, Polish lady, warning about the things that she has seen in Poland starting to unfold in UK. And this is control of local authorities. So it's a very interesting discussion. We've also got the Freedom Alliance have got their on X meeting. So details are here. That's 7 p.m. tonight. But if you go to freedomalliance.co.uk, you can find out more on that. Well, where does that bring us? It brings us into chaos and confusion in local authorities. And of course, one of the big problems coming to the surface at the moment is that many authorities in UK are heading rapidly towards bankruptcy. The BBC's report on it is here. I couldn't resist just showing a little bit of their image. Vital services or financial ruin, England's town hall dilemma. And if we bring in that text again, it says from bin collections and street lighting to child protection and elderly care, councils provide services we all use, but in England more and more in danger of going bust. BBC Panorama has followed the struggles of one such authority and the people who rely on it. Now, I'm going to say I haven't seen the detail of BBC Panorama, but the BBC's reporting simply fails to get into the detail of what's actually happening with these councils. But if we have a look at some of the key points that they flag up, if we press the button, we should be able to bring in the arrow. There we go. Funding for councils across England is calculated on census information from 13 years ago. And then it says Havering has 10% more people living in the borough than 2011. This is key because the country has got a huge increase in the number of people now living in UK, but this is one of the subjects the BBC doesn't want to discuss. It also says that 70% of that particular council spending goes on social care for adults and children, and that is a topic the UK column has been warning about for a great many years. We've also got legal changes in 2015, the number of young people in England eligible for education, health and care plans, part funded by the councils has doubled to more than 500,000. So we have more and more problems in basic education. And then another statement here, in 10 years, the amount spent per person on children's services by town halls has risen from £120 to £212. 77% increase, and equivalent adult social care spend is up from 252 to 372. If we do a crude analysis of what's happening here, we've simply got the costs of breakdown. We can't look after our children. We can't look after our elderly people. We've got a lot of people with emotional trouble, physical and mental health problems, and all of this costs money. We are looking at society that has not broken down. We're looking at society that is being broken down, its policy. And if we move on to a slightly different area, but still with local councils, we've got a March 2024 report just out on the low traffic neighbourhoods. So this is a research report which the government has commissioned as to how it is all going. You can see the detail of it here, but we've just pulled out a little bit of the detail to have a look at. So if we bring the first bit on screen, it says stakeholders across the sample interviewed felt that the LTNs were introduced in a rush. Stakeholders in transport-related organisations thought there was a disconnect between the transport sector's view of the LTNs and those of the public. So we've got confusion and chaos. And then lastly down here, stakeholders across the sample stressed that they do not yet know the impact of the LTNs. So this is all government policy that's been absolutely rushed in, and now we're seeing the fruits are more confusion and chaos between the public and transport providers and other so-called stakeholders. But if we go to conclusions here, we've got this one. While the review of existing evidence show that LTN schemes have several positive impacts, albeit with more uncertainty in terms of economic ones, this remains largely unrecognised by stakeholders or residents in the four schemes where the survey research was conducted. Apologies, a couple of typos there, but we're talking uncertainty about the schemes. And then it says low awareness of the schemes amongst residents and uncertainty about benefits does not automatically translate into widespread opposition. So the government showing its fearful here, the people that are now challenging these low traffic schemes are, they're not actually forcing enough because the government thinks it's just under control. People are pushing back, but not enough to cause the government problems. And if we bring in this last conclusion again, in summary, this research has found a mixed picture in terms of LTN's measurable impacts, at least in the short term, plus a degree of uncertainty of in terms of perceived impact. These are related factors and underline the importance of collecting robust evidence over time, as well as achieving better communications. That should be being able to demonstrate positive impacts ought to improve the reputation of LTNs. So too would improvements to community engagement, awareness and understanding. So if we read through that text in more general way, the public really don't understand what all this is about, and they need to be properly educated and convinced. The government's got their best interests at heart, but unfortunately the public not quite bright enough to understand what's going on. And if we bring in a little bit of commentary from the political scene, we've got Louise High here, MP, Labour Shadow Transport Secretary. She said the publication of this LTN guidance was a blatant and desperate attempt to distract people from a government that has, quote, run out of road. Well, okay, little bit of a joke there. But what interests us is that if we go back to 2013, and we just bring that in on screen, we've got Nicholas Bowles, MP, who was quoted at that time in The Guardian and elsewhere, that the Prime Minister and his deputy, Nick Clegg, want their people power revolution to unleash chaotic effects across local communities. He said chaotic, therefore, in our vocabulary, he's talking about the Conservatives, is a good thing. And if we bring in his fellow colleague here, Danny Kruger, so Danny was a one-time advisor, and he was forced to resign as a Tory candidate for Sedgefield after he was quoted as saying that the Conservatives plan to introduce a period of creative destruction in the public services. Now, I'm going to say, if we look out of the window at what's happening in our public services, we're absolutely seeing breakdown everywhere we look. Breakdown in education, breakdown in the budgetary system, breakdown in road repairs, breakdown in social services and health. This is not accidental. This is planned. And these men were warning and warning what was actually going to come. So if we bring in Eric Pickles, because at the time he was the local government secretary, he didn't leave any doubt about what the Conservatives were going to do. He said, we're going to shake up the balance of power in this country. We're going to change the nature of the constitution. Be in no doubt about our commitment to localism. I know I look like an unlikely revolutionary, but the revolution starts here. So I'll have a question for you in a minute, Alex, on this one. But I'm also going to add what was being released around the same time was information talking about both Labour and the Conservatives using the work of activist and revolutionary Saul Alinsky. So this was a report on Labour, was talking about what Labour was doing. And it was also pointing out that the philosophy of the political action was theorized by American activist Saul Alinsky in the 1930s. So what was Saul Alinsky? Well, he was a radical. He wanted major change in society. He was very happy to praise Lucifer. And this is the agenda that both political parties are now introducing into the UK. Let's have a look at the Conservatives, because they were also labelled in this expose of what was happening. And here at the bottom, we can see that for the Conservatives, they were using Saul Alinsky and Paulo Freire. So what was this about? Well, it was about changing the organisation of basic society, using community groups in order to destabilize and bring in a turbulence through which the main globalist policy could appear. And if we bring Saul Alinsky's book on screen, here it is, Saul Alinsky's Rules for Radicals. You can get this quite easily as a PDF. And I think most people will be shocked at the viewpoints expressed in this book. So, Alex, very, very quickly, to me, it's no accident that we've got this chaos unleashed in our society, because this is the smokescreen through which the main globalist policies are going to come.
Quite so, Brian. It's not just in the modern era with Marxism revolutionary spirit that this has been said. It's been the main criticism levelled at such thinking down the ages, ancient Gnosticism and onwards, that this thinking centres around must destroy, with no idea of what to rebuild next. Many Alinskyites in Britain, America and elsewhere will openly say, to heck with what comes next, what's important first is to tear down. If you want a two-word summary by the masterful James Lindsay, Lindsay with an AY, previously interviewed by UK Column, and many good talks of his on YouTube. A two-word summary by him, I would say the world expert speaker now on the problem of Alinskyites' agitation. It is that it stops at the utterance, not that. Whatever I see in culture, in history, in government, not that. Mustn't have any religion, mustn't have any morals. To hell with it all. And this is now coming through the Conservatives. It's blue Marxism. And I'm starting to say to people lately that blue Marxism from the Conservatives turns out to be more potent than its red Marxist cousin.
Okay, thank you for that, Alex. Well, we can discuss more on that subject in UK Column Extra. Mark, let's bring you back in, because what have we got to say on constitutional rights?
And Brian, the missing constitutional right this coming Wednesday, March 20th, and I'm signed up to cover this virtually for UK Column. It's being presented by the Brennan Center for Justice at New York University at Washington, D.C. New York University has a branch in Washington, D.C. It's being presented by Richard L. Hazen and Wilfred U. Codrington III, and that they're shown in the slide there. Again, I'll be covering this. This is just a preview of what's going to be coming up on my report next week. The John Bradamus Center at New York University is also involved in this. Inspired by its founder, the former congressman and NYU president emeritus, the John Bradamus Center of New York University pursues a collection of initiatives in the areas the state of Congress and the legislative process and democracies, the shifting dynamics in foreign policy and international affairs, and the present state and future prospects for higher education, et cetera. Art and culture is involved. It formed the core of John Bradamus's life and public service. And we'll go on from there. With a growing reputation as a home for informed and civil debate on politics, public policy, and other major issues facing the nation and the global community, the NYU Bradamus Center, in conjunction with the Brennan Outfit, undertakes programs at NYU's campuses in New York and D.C. and increasingly around NYU's global network. That's just some general background. But the missing constitutional right, and that's the program I'll be covering Wednesday. It says the right to vote is one of the foundations of democracy, yet in the United States, it's never been truly available to all. Generations have seen different versions of the same conflict, disenfranchised groups of vote of people fighting for their right to cast a ballot. Today, this struggle continues with attempts to prohibit some Americans from voting, such as those with criminal convictions, and deter others from voting, such as minority groups. But what this is really about is whether voting should actually be a constitutional right enshrined in the U.S. Constitution itself. Many would argue that that's redundant and unnecessary. Anyway, the author Richard Hazen is going to argue Wednesday, as he does in his new book, A Real Right to Vote, that a constitutional amendment to the U.S. Constitution would end the fight, supposedly, over the franchise of voting. But could it be that simple, Hazen is asking? And perhaps more importantly, is there a way to overcome the politics of voter suppression and to convince both parties to enshrine this right for everyone? Well, the real problem here, gentlemen, is that the U.S. Constitution already presupposes that you have a basic right to vote. It provides the basic provision that we elect a member of Congress every 2 years, and that the congressional districts are based on population. And originally, the U.S. states were supposed to appoint the U.S. senators. The Constitution was amended with the 17th Amendment to allow popular election of U.S. senators, which many argue is a grave mistake, that it created a hornet's nest for more fraud in elections and made getting elected to the Senate more about money more than about policy. And then the president was always supposed to be a mixed bag of the Electoral College and some popular vote. In my opinion, this is a surreptitious way to try and get at the Electoral College and winnow it down even more, or maybe even try and get rid of it. That's my view of what's going on here. We'll see how things bear out. But basically, the Constitution already, many would argue, provides for this, and this looks like a radical way to try and alter the Constitution. And it basically ignores the problems with vote counting and puts all the onus on voting rights and vote casting. So as the slide indicates, that'll be this coming Wednesday at 3 p.m. I'll be covering it virtually for UK Column, and I'll have more on this next week. But it sounds like something revolutionary is afoot, and we just need to sniff it out.
Okay. Mark, thank you very much for that. You've got an image on screen here.
Oh, yeah. I was adjusting for some of the time, but John Brademas is the namesake of the Brademas Center at New York University. And he was an American politician, an educator originally from Indiana, a congressman that represented Indiana's 3rd District. He was a majority whip for the U.S. House of Reps for the Democratic Party from 1977 to 1981 at the conclusion of his 20-year career as a congressman. And a quick personal footnote is I knew a lot of members in Northern Indiana a few years ago with the John Birch Society, and they saw this 13th president of New York University. And they, when he was a congressman, actually, the Birch Society worked very hard to get him ousted from his congressional seat. And they were very active at that time, and they claim to have been successful in shortening his congressional career. So he was a very controversial figure, Mr. Brademas.
Okay, Mark, thank you very much for that. Well, Alex, let's bring you back in. If America is a teetering democracy, does it get any better in Germany?
It gets a lot worse in Germany, and precisely because of this federal and state level agency for the protection of the Constitution. The things that Mark was telling us about a moment ago, we must have democracy, there ain't no other way. It's very bad to say that democracy is not the best system. Things that have been virtually outlawed without legislation by His Majesty's government in the past weeks and months, they've really hit with a vengeance in Germany, because this goes back decades earlier because of Germany's unique history in the matter. Junge Freiheit is the magazine, I would say the premier conservative and constitutionalist publication in Germany, which has carried this title, which turned out to be far and away the most read thing they've ever published. So the byline above the headline is schoolgirl, she's 16, that's not in the headline, schoolgirl marched away, frog marched out of education. That detail is now controversial, as I may get to. And then the main headline, a quotation from her mother: "What was done to my daughter is something I wouldn't have thought possible." What is this all about? Well, the detail for those who speak German is best summarized in Kontrafuchs' flagship Sunday format with Burkhard Müller-Ulrich, the Sonntagsrunde. Kontrafunk is based in Germany and Switzerland and has an Austrian branch as well. But I'll give the long and the short of it here. So we have a young lady who, a couple of months ago, posted a couple of TikTok videos. One of them said that Germany and the Smurfs have something in common. She said they're both blue. Now, blue, as you may recall, if you've seen my recent presentations of electoral polling, in this particularly Eastern Germany, is the colour of the Alternative für Deutschland Party, which is now north of the 20% support barrier, sending the authorities scuttling in panic in those Eastern German states. Now, where this happened, this frog marching was, in fact, at the top of Eastern Germany, in a small town which is right on the Baltic coast and in a very conservative area, which survived the worst of being in the East German system. So this has shocked the locals. So that was the first thing that that came to the authorities' attention about this young lady. And for that reason, this Kontrafunk episode has been subtitled Staatsschutzrelevante Schlümpfe, or Smurfs of Interest to Homeland Security. Now, the second post which the young lady made was that she said, Deutschland ist kein Ort, sondern Heimat. Germany isn't a place on the map. It is a home country or a home or a homeland. Any of those is a valid translation for Heimat. It's a German term for where you feel at home. These two statements were decided by the state police of Mecklenburg-Vorpommern, and particularly the counterterrorism people, the Verfassungsschutz, to be what they call verfassungsfeindlich, inimical to the constitution, not verfassungswidrig or unconstitutional, but they used this term, which only appears once or twice in the German penal code, and then only with reference to the display of Nazi symbology. So they invented it out of whole cloth that there was such a thing as staatsfeindlich or verfassungsfeindlicher Inhalt or content on it online inimical to the constitution. And here's where it gets nasty. The headmaster of the school and the police, when asked by Junge Freiheit and others about this, say, oh no, she wasn't frog marched out. No, no, not at all. The police simply stood at the door of the chemistry classroom and the headmaster called her out to have a word with the police. So the police were just escorting the headmaster, you see. Every detail has been lied about until they're blue in the face. The kind of protocol the young lady was given, which is called a Gefährderansprache, or a formal caution that one is a risk or at risk, isn't part of Mecklenburg-Vorpommern state law. It is in other states like Lower Saxony. And where it is on the statute books, you must, of course, as a minor citizen, have a parent or guardian with you, which she didn't. What she was told is, for your own safety, where have we heard that before, you must stop posting this content inimical to the Constitution. We don't have a time for a long constitutional discussion, but constitutions bind our governments. And this isn't just an abstract philosophical point. When you get to a supranational body like the EU, there are all kinds of other checks and balances supposedly in the system precisely because these bodies can bind the individual, right? So state bodies trying to say the constitution applies to you as an individual is absolutely expressly rejected by Western countries as part of their model, nowhere more so than in Germany because of their history. So these people are acting off the cuff. When the Interior Ministry of the state was asked what they'd done, one of the things that happened was that the Interior Minister said, and that's called, a guy called Christoph Pegel, I am quite convinced that what was done was proportionate. So that's how useful the proportionality test is. It's completely subjective. Another thing was that the police, who had frog-marched the girl through the school, turned around to Junge Freiheit, the magazine that broke the story, and said, this girl is a vulnerable minor. You shouldn't be reporting on her because she's vulnerable. Because of her age. The discussion that was done on Kontrafunk about this included the detail that in the neighboring states of Brandenburg, also an AfD-leaning state in eastern Germany, they now have systematic political loyalty tests for state employees, for civil servants. The rebuttal by the Norddeutsches Rundfunk, the state-funded media for that part of Germany, was so one-sided a defense of the state authorities that they even described right-wing organs as having alleged that the police removed the young lady from classes. And also the Interior Ministry tacitly admitted that there was trauma in the school by replying to journalists, at no time was there need for educational psychological support at this school after the incident. So we'll now bring on screen Remix News, which is very good on Germany and Central Europe. They have German teen pulled out of classroom and questioned by police for TikTok post stating Germany is her home. In the German original, she didn't even say that, although the text didn't say that. It just said it is a home for people. And look at this detail. When the mother questioned the school principal or headmaster and said, why don't you contact me first, or indeed have a word with my daughter first if you think there's a problem with my daughter, he, quote, told me that he wasn't allowed to do that. He was told to inform the police immediately. This man is reportedly young and a Wessi, so he's drafted in from Aachen on the Dutch border, very liberal West German city. So that seems to be part of the problem, that because of his generation, background and mindset, he thinks that anything that comes from the Interior Ministry or the Education Ministry, including, as we reported recently, we must crack down on AFD, no matter how innocuous, he thinks that's law. He doesn't see that the judiciary and the parliament have a role in government. Everything comes straight from the executive in these people's minds. The discussion on Contrafung majored on this, that this was an exemplary modern headmaster by Nancy Faeser's terms at the German Interior Ministry, although it's a federal state, no, she shouldn't be fiddling with individual states' education systems. But he's obeying what orders he's hearing from the top, which is that AFD are the enemy. So the long and the short of it was that they are protecting this, these new kind of headmasters are protecting the state and do not see any duty of care either to the pupils or duty of candor to their parents. I suppose I would ask, with a lot of this stuff going on in Britain now, is it the case that a lot of headmasters in Britain think the same way, that they're there for the state? So what's happened this morning, an update that we've got, I think this is the very same high school in Ribnitz, but I can't confirm yet. Some activists have put up this banner, Heimatliebe ist kein Verbrechen. It's not a crime to love your home country. And the most pithy discussion of aphorism about this phrase that I heard in the radio show there was, im Kleinen zeigt sich das Große, little things show us which way the wind is blowing. If you think this is just a German problem, well, look at our Prevent coverage, especially Debbie's recent interview, Prevented Education, here on ukcolumn.org. And look at this also from Massachusetts, not even the wacko coastal part of Massachusetts, but deep into western Massachusetts on the Connecticut state line, which is the part that's supposed to mirror middle America and be a placid backwater. 6 8th graders, that's 13-year-olds, facing criminal charges. Again, a jumped-up district attorney, a state prosecutor, thinking that he can do this. And if you follow the link on the next page here, Litoria, the first link in that page will take you to a very swaggering presentation by the district attorney in question, Mr. Guluni, simply saying these 13-year-olds in a private chat saying nasty things about black people were infringing the civil rights of people. And that's a crime. That the crime is threatening, threatening to commit a crime. That's what they've been charged with. Although there was no direct speech to these people, and we don't know what the threats are. A very politicized DA. So, you know, it's happening even in the one country in the world, the USA, where you constitutionally cannot get the idea of hate speech. Well, at least you can't federally, but the states and the counties and the districts are now trying.
Alex, thank you very much for that. Some really serious matters there. We'll bring some of that discussion into extra time. And Mark, I'm going to say to you, we'll also bring your World Health Organization section into extra time. So, Alex, just take us out, close today's news with your little report on constituency results over there in Ireland.
A few days ago voted no in kind of two-thirds level majorities to two proposed amendments to the Irish Constitution, Bunreacht na hÉireann, that the government had been cheerleading for together with the state-funded media, RTE. And the questions were, should we get rid of the constitutional article which says that it doesn't say a woman's place is in the home, as it was often presented as saying. It was saying that because we as a state cannot function without women's duties in the home, we will not jeopardize women's role in the home. And the second vote, which also was embarrassingly for the government overturned, was should we redefine marriage so that it's not the basis of the family, but that any so-called durable relationship, never been tested in jurisprudence, that would be the basis. And the Irish people were canny enough to see through that, except if we put that back on screen, in the one constituency in the bottom corner of County Dublin, in the inset there, that's the constituency of Dunleary, the port where many people may have entered Ireland from. Everywhere else in the country, including everywhere in County Dublin, other than Dunleary, said no.
Okay, Alex, thank you very much for that. Well, I'm just going to end by echoing a comment that somebody made during today's news in our chat box, and they said, has the system become worse or has the veil been lifted? I'm going to say, no, the system is getting worse and the veil is being lifted. So two things are happening simultaneously, the system is getting worse, it's accelerating, but also the veil is coming off. And remember that whilst we can still speak, we need to do everything we possibly can to lift the rocks and show what's really happening. Because if we lose free speech, as Alex has been indicating in particular, then we will simply be unable to fight. So it's up to all of us, UK Column. It's also up to our audience. Get out there, get speaking up, and point out the things which are clearly wrong. We'll end there. Thanks very much for joining us for today's news. If you're a member, please do stay with us for another few minutes, and we'll be running UK Column Extra to talk about more of today's news in more detail. We'll see you then. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.